This is a film that was prepared about 1950 by a group of businessmen in Naugatuck who sought to promote Naugatuck as a good place to have a business. Here we see Lou Dibble, who was well known as the leader of the Wisdom Manufacturing Company and later involved in the Eastern Malleable Iron Company, Mr. McCullum and other people, Will Moody, who was president of the Water Company, who were interested in Naugatuck as a good place to establish business. Here we have Bob Sutherland, we have Hilding Olson, president of the Savings Bank, and several other leading citizens in Naugatuck interested in its business and commercial development. These are just odd shots of people outdoors. Phil Rice, who was active in town, served as mayor at one time. And this is Bill Soper, who was one of the narrators of the film when it originally was made. Unfortunately, the soundtrack of this film has been lost. So it is necessary now to try to add some narrative to it so that it makes some sense. Here we have Elmer Schmidt, who ran the Naugatuck Hardware Company, and several others, and Don Brubaker, who was active in the Lewis Engineering Company, are apparently examining the film. And this is Tom Scally, who was actually responsible for this film. Here is a view of Naugatuck, showing particularly the rubber company buildings and various other things and some of the residential development that occurred about the time the film was made. Naugatuck is a rather hilly town and in its early days tried to be a farming community, but that didn't work very well, so it got into manufacturing. Here we have youngsters coming out of school. And here we have a couple of citizens looking at World War I Memorial, which was erected in 1921, and which is still on the Horseshoe area near Salem School. This has a large flagpole on a marble base. It took several years to build this after the war, since they had to raise funds for the purpose. This is the Civil War monument, which was dedicated in 1885 and is still on the green. It was made by the Reigate Granite Company in Reigate, Vermont, and lists some of the famous battles of the Civil War where Naugatuck people were involved. Here we have the fountain that was put on the green, a gift of Mr. Whittemore as a part of the development of the green. This is the World War II memorial. Now we are moving out to the western part of the town and what is known as Gun Town, and this is the Gun Memorial. That cemetery contains many of the early settlers in that particular area, many of whom were members of the Gun family. And this is a view of the cemetery, which has many old monuments in it because it goes back to the fairly early 1700s. It looks pretty much the same today. And here's a memorial to Sarah Gunn, who was the wife of Nathaniel Gunn, one of the founders of that area in town. These are views of some of the early houses in the Guntown area. Now this jumps to Union City and the Porter Inn, which was built in the 1700s and where some of George Washington's soldiers stayed while on campaign in this area. There is a monument on the side of the building that claimed that George Washington stayed there, but later research showed that he didn't, though some of his men did. This is the Collins Inn down in Straitsville. Straitsville was once a very important part of the town. That was demolished a few years ago. Now we are going up Church Street. You can see the old town hall up there on the right. The tower of the Congregational Church and the Episcopal Church in front of it. Many of the shops along the street. This used to be a very active area where most of the retail business in town occurred. There's the Naugatuck Hardware Company in the Nary Building. And this is the Nary Building built as a memorial to Mr. Nary, who had run a bottling plant down on Water Street. His son was a lawyer who erected that building as a memorial to his father. Here we have the green, and you can see the cars of the period. Traffic on Church Street was pretty active, particularly in the middle of the day. Now we are over on South Main Street, the Bass Building, and then the Nichols Hall. This was a large building built in the 1850s to provide retail stores on the first floor. And then up on the third floor was a large hall where many events occurred, school commencements and exhibitions and such things. These are a few of the stores along South Main Street when that was a very active commercial area before Route 8 was changed and made it necessary to remove much of this sort of thing. Of course, the dominant industry in Naugatuck for many years was the United States Rubber Company, which was organized under that name in 1892 and was a combination of a number of rubber industries. And it was of considerable size and covered much of the downtown area. It had started as two small rubber shops and gradually grew and grew until it employed some thousands of people. Now this has all been demolished. This shows some of the processing that went on at the time this film was made. The crude rubber came into the plant, was broken up. As you can see here, it is being forced out here and loaded into countering machines, big rollers which pressed this into sheets so that it could be handled in a better way and utilized. They put it through these machines several times. You used to be able to walk along North Water Street and see these machines operating. You could see through the windows of the building, and they often operated night and day. Here they are refeeding the machines with the rubber that's already been through so that it can be compressed further. Now we're into some of the operations at the rubber company, which particularly was noted for rubber shoes and arctics and overshoes. And here, here they are applying the tips to one form of shoe. These were done by conveyor belts that moved along, and it required operators that were all set to do whatever the operation they were to do could be applied right away, because if one person held up the conveyor, it took a while to get things straightened out again. So that these girls, she just applied a sole to the shoe, and everything had to be done right on schedule as these machines moved, as these things moved along by the conveyor. Here they are all finished, moving along, ready to be packed. Quite a variety of styles. They had designers who specialized in designing these. This is against the background showing tobogganing. These are, of course, things for use in the snow and in the winter time. There were all kinds of styles, high ones, low ones. Here is the Eastern Malleable Iron Company office and foundry number 6, which was right next to it on Bridge Street. This was demolished some years ago. At one time, the foundry was extremely active. It was established in 1858. Here we are in the molding department, where they are filling the molds with sand, ready to put the patterns in so that they can pour iron into the molds. This was tough work. You had to work rather rapidly. Here they are pouring the iron. It's coming out of the furnace. The molders had to have their ladles ready just at the right moment. When the person before them got his full, he got out of the way, and the next one got in line. Because once the iron started flowing, it kept on flowing until that heat was pretty well over. This was tough work, particularly in the summertime, when the furnace heat not only was tough, but was combined with horrible temperatures outside and no air conditioning. Here they're filling the molds. They had a whole row of them, and they filled one after another until their ladle was empty. Then the next molder had to be ready to carry on the work. Here you see a pattern for casting, and down below are the valve handles that have been cast from that mold. The Naugatuck Glass Company on Bridge Street was established by Mr. Witherwax, who had been in charge of glass at the Waterbury Clock Company, most of which came from Germany. After the World War I, it was not possible to get that, and they set up a department of making glass. Here the girl is turning a cutter or a scriber that cuts a circle of a specific diameter. Then she takes and picks up the square piece and taps it and breaks out the circle. And then that is applied to a pile with paper between so that the pieces of glass do not get scratched. This is to be a convex glass. It's a flat glass which is put in a layer or a special furnace. A device comes down and presses it and forms it. You can see it's highly crowned. This is quite a tricky art. Here's a clock showing that kind of glass that curves out over the dial. They also process glass with a lot of marking on it, processes to put these things on the glass. Here's one for advertising Pepsi Cola. That went on clocks that went to grocery stores and such. Naugatuck Chemical was an important part of Naugatuck and still is. That's the part that remains of the rubber industry. And this was established in the early days of this century to provide sulfuric acid, which was needed in the processing of rubber, in order to be sure that they had a supply. They also got into more and more other chemical articles, and when synthetic rubber came along, they were involved in processing that and kept expanding and building many buildings, and it still covers quite an area. These are tanks for containing probably butadiene or something they were using at that time in connection with synthetic rubber. Chemical works required very complicated equipment, and all sorts of venting and scrubbers to eliminate offensive materials. These are some of the office and laboratory buildings. And in the laboratory, you see the girls doing testing and so forth. All kinds of chemical equipment, glassware, and so forth. The Bristol Company was founded by Professor Bristol, who was a mathematics professor down in Hoboken, New Jersey, at Stevens Institute of Technology, and started in a small way of making recording instruments and also belt lacing to connect leather belts that were used in industry. And this expanded to quite a degree. These are some of the buildings. They had quite complicated machinery to process the materials they used. This is at the height of industry in this area, particularly in Naugatuck and Waterbury, where a great deal of metalworking was done. Here a man is withdrawing bar stock to put in a screw machine that will process it and make parts out of it. Some of these machines are very complicated and were built specifically for doing these jobs. These are small parts being turned out of a machine and going through certain processes. Here are some of the recording instruments being set up, the parts having been made and assembled. This is a kind of assembly line where they are installing the various mechanisms. Some of these involve quite a bit of electronic equipment. Had circuits that were set up and then installed in the equipment. Here you see the disc that records the various things that this machine is indicating. Here we have the Perry Press, which was founded about 1885 in Naugatuck and active until fairly recent years. What remained of their building burned a few years back. Presses by this time had become quite automatic too, so that they picked up the paper, moved it under the press printed it, then picked it up and moved it over and piled it ready for packaging. This is apparently a linotype machine or something that is turning out type to be set up for some particular printing job. The original narration probably explained each of these operations in detail, but since we no longer have that, we have to kind of guess at what some of these operations are. The John Russell Company was out in Millville. It was founded by John Russell and utilized the old Naugatuck manufacturing buildings in Millville. They had moved over to North Church Street to Mr. Twitchell's factory, and they did a number of operations in small metal parts, particularly making sash chain, which was pieces of brass stamped out by power presses, and then they were automatically formed and linked together. Here are some of the pieces that are being put in one of the stages of the operation. These machines, see, move everything automatically. Here the pieces are being formed into a chain, one piece into the next link, and formed down so that the successive one could be added. These machines were quite marvels of operation and interesting to watch, because they were doing many things which once had to all be done by hand. The Butterfield Company occupied one of the older industrial buildings in Naugatuck. It was once a satinette mill, built in the 1840s at the foot of Church Street on Rubber Avenue. The Butterfield Company utilized the property to do Bakelite molding. Bakelite is a phenolic material in powder form which is put in a press with a mold, and the press compresses the material and combines it into a solid piece. Bakelite is one of the early plastic materials that was used extensively in this area, and the Butterfield Company specialized in this. They made housings for aircraft instruments. They made many parts used in the automobile field. Naugatuck Manufacturing Company was on North Main Street. Originally, it was the Twitchell Company making hardware for umbrellas, but the Naugatuck Manufacturing Company specialized in making metal parts, particularly by spinning. Here there is a wooden form. Against it is placed a piece of copper held in a rotating arbor and a lathe, and a man applies that tool and forms it over the mold. And then those pieces are soldered together and provide a float for a valve. This is the Duval Company down the lower end of town, which produced also some copper parts and made sprayers for insecticides and things of that sort. They made valves, and then they made chambers that contained the insecticide. They fitted these things together. It had a handle you pushed, which atomized the liquid. Here we are down in the Risden Company area. Risden also specialized in metalworking, particularly deep drawing, that is, taking flat metal and putting it into tooling and equipment which forms it into small pieces. Risden started out in Waterbury but was not in a good state and was offered for sale for about $10,000 in 1905, around there, might have been 1910. And a group of businessmen in Naugatuck got together and decided to buy it and move the equipment to Naugatuck and started making small parts. They had a rough time at first until they got a big order from the Paris Garter Company that used small metal parts that had to be punched out with punch and dies and then formed. They also made safety pins and common pins in large numbers. When I was a kid, there were women dragging little wagons around filled with pins, which they took home and mounted on cardboard for sales promotion purposes. They were put on these cards and then distributed to retail stores. Here we have power presses that are punching out small parts. Well, the presses operated pretty much themselves. Usually there was somebody there to be sure nothing happened that stopped the press or was doing the operation in such a way that the parts were defective, so they had to be inspected every now and then. Here a girl is taking them as they came from some preceding operation and putting them in a piece of equipment that picks up one at a time and performs an additional operation on it, inspecting a part to be sure that everything is going properly. Many of these parts were polished by tumbling. They were put in barrels that rotated, and as they rubbed on each other, or sometimes there were tacks or other things put in there to attack the surface and provide it with a shiny texture. These all had to be made and finished up in accordance with the customer's needs. Peter Paul was a candy maker who started out in a small shop on Maple Street in the old Moulthrop block, then moved down Church Street, and gradually became a real industry where candy was produced in large numbers. Here chocolate is being unwrapped, and you will see some of the processes of making the candy. Here it's put in a conveyor which carries it as it comes from the package. These are some of the products that are semi-finished, like mounds which have coconut on them. Here a girl is checking them up to be sure they're lined up properly for some operation. Here they are already boxed, ready for shipping. She is simply lining up the boxes so that they can be packaged to be shipped out of the factory. Lewis Engineering Company started out down in the same building that Butterfield was, but as their business expanded, they moved up into the old Harris Whittemore Senior house on Church Street, the so-called brown shingled house. It was an interesting house. All the shingles were made in Middlebury and were 1 inch thick. This was a company that specialized in making instruments. It was originally planning to make aircraft, complete airplane, and it did make a couple in conjunction with some other people. But it was finally decided that the undertaking of manufacturing a complete aircraft was far too expensive, so they specialized in the instrumentation end of it, particularly temperature indicators for engine temperature and such. These are magnetic assemblies that have a moving coil in them that have to go through various operations and be wired up. Here they have been installed in a movement. This is a dual instrument. It has two movements in it. Then these instruments have to be calibrated so that the temperature or whatever is being indicated is correct all along the scale. All of this test equipment was built by Lewis for its own purposes, since it was not something that could be commercially purchased. Here a pyrometer is being checked. You know, this is a hot and cold chamber to test the accuracy of the instruments at various temperatures, because aircraft instrument specifications required this. Here we see them working on a pyrometer which was used by the automotive industry. This is a formatic company on Spring Street, which also was a metalworking factory, processing various metal parts from sheet metal into formed parts used for various industries, electrical and otherwise. Here's a machine doing multiple operations and processing things of various sizes. Formatic was later acquired by Raytheon. Again, after any machine is adjusted or new stock is put in, it is sometimes necessary to check the first samples that come through to be sure that they meet specifications. The Roberts Plating Company was up on Prospect Street, and part of it was in quite an old building that had been one of the Fulling Millbrook factories, small factories that operated in the early days. The Roberts Company took over one of these and expanded and did a lot of plating for local industry, where brass parts had to be nickel plated to meet specification. Here is a tumbling barrel that is polishing up the parts after they have been plated, or in some cases preparing them for plating. The Valley Buffing Company was a small operation which actually did buffing. Buffing is a difficult operation to put a sheen on metal, because it's rather messy. It involves the use of rouge and holding the part as a spinning wheel that is charged with rouge polishes the piece. It's not the sort of thing that OSHA likes, because a lot of the material, the polishing compound, gets into the air and is not particularly good for your respiratory system or your eyes. This is some kind of a washing operation. I'm not exactly sure just what it is, apparently. Oh, that I believe actually was the Peerless Laundry, or one of the laundry operations where they have large washing machines, and then this is a big mangle to press a large piece of cloth. Back before washing machines were common, many people sent their laundry to a commercial laundry who did the washing and pressing. And of course, sometimes it involved very large pieces of material, so they had to have large mangles with heated rollers, which pressed the thing, and the cloth came out the opposite end, all ready for folding. This was very hot work in the summertime, because the mangles and other pressing devices, here a shirt is being pressed, a sleeve, then the main part of the shirt is being pressed, then it is put on something to press the collar, and then the cuffs are pressed, and all this of course involves a lot of heat, so that in the summertime working in a laundry was a difficult task. Then the girls fold them, put a band of paper around them, and they are delivered to the customer in this way. To show that Naugatuck was not only commercial, it was decided to show some of the churches in town. This is St. Michael's Church, which is near the green. This was built in 1875, and it is apparently Easter time, because the altar is covered with Easter lilies and many, many flowers. And the people in attendance are shown coming out of the church with their wearing flowers and so forth, corsages and such. They probably felt Easter Sunday would be a good time to take church pictures, because people are dressed up in their Sunday best, and in many cases have bows and flowers on their hats and corsages and such things. These are attendants coming out of St. Michael's Church, getting in their cars. That was Jack Smut. This is Art Fogger, who used to be a salesman for the Friedman Company. This is the Congregational Church, which was finished in 1905, and we have various people coming out of that church, and this may also be an Easter Sunday. Since the two churches are near the green, they probably took this film at the same time. Here is Lou Dibble, one of his daughters. This is Russ Weaving, who ran the sport shop on Church Street. And various other people who attended the Congregational Church. Here we have moved, I believe this is St. Francis Church they are coming out of. Again, Easter Sunday with lots of corsages and flowers. Thank you. Here we are at St. Hedwig's Church in Union City, which was built to provide church facilities for the Polish people in Union City, and most of whom lived in that section at that time. The church was quite near Prospect Street, up on the hill there, and had some quite elegant stained glass windows. This church, I believe, is Holy Savior up on Church Street further. I mean up on Main Street. Another Polish church. Here is St. Mary's Church, which was, the cornerstone was laid about 1908, and the building was finished in the night around 1920. They used the basement section first, just as St. Francis had when it was built in 1882, and then the upper part was finished in 1890. This was quite a handsome twin Gothic tower church. Still much the same, except that the front doors have been changed to some more modern form. This is Hillside Congregational Church, which was established in 1894 and is having its 100th anniversary this year. This was a wooden church to serve the Swedish community that was not Lutheran. There was a Salem Lutheran Church on Salem Street. This is that church. This was built in the 1880s to serve much of the Swedish group in town who began coming here in the 1880s. This church looks much the same as it did here, except that it had some transepts added and was enlarged with a large brick addition in the back. I don't know if this is still Easter Sunday. I doubt that they photographed everybody on Easter Sunday. This is Emmanuel Lutheran Church up on High Street, which sits up very high, and the tower can be seen all around town. This was the rectory for that church. Fifty years ago, Naugatuck was quite a church-going community. Church attendance doesn't seem to be as popular today as it was in those days. This is a Methodist church on Meadow Street. That was originally down on Water Street, then it was moved to the corner of Church and Maple Street, and then they built a new building about 1885 over on Meadow Street, and then this is that building, much altered and made into colonial style later on. I believe this was done about, in the late 20s probably. This is a view of Holy Savior Church as it stood on North Main Street. This was swept away in the flood of 55. It was not very old. It was a nice brick building and quite attractive in form. And unfortunately, it suffered terribly as the water came down Main Street and swept everything away. This is the little chapel on Prospect Street that has served different congregations at different times. Here we see some of the building projects in Naugatuck, particularly school buildings, which because of increasing population had to be built. Still a problem in Naugatuck to keep up with population growth. I'm not sure which building this is. This could be either a commercial building or a school building. It may be Cross Street School. Of course, building techniques had greatly changed with all the metal framing and then filling in with brick. Most of our schools had been built of wood in the early days until Salem was built. Schools for a while had a great deal of glass in them, but then it was found the heat that this generated from the sun was too great, so that type of construction. This is Bill Boy's house. He was president of the Naugatuck National Bank. This was Carlton Bristol's house. This was up in the Whittemore development up off North Church Street. This was Mr. Dibble's house, which is still standing. Had quite a bit of green lawn to it. This house is on North Church Street and belonged to the Bradbury family, but was later acquired by Fred Zanino. Then there were a number of houses on smaller scale. Those were very large houses for the most part. And many of these developments that then sprang up used a sort of basic standard pattern for the house, but varied it by adding dormers or omitting them, adding small entrances and so forth. This is in Union City. This is the Bridge Street Bridge that used to be there when this brick development was put up with many apartments. This unfortunately suffered greatly in the flood, though it didn't destroy the buildings. The water from Hop Brook got into the buildings and damaged things in the basements and first floors. Naugawam Village was another development. We had a lot of development in the 1940-50 period. One might almost say overdevelopment. It grew so fast that it was difficult to take care of the youngsters of these families. It required a good deal of school building. Some of the housing was put up by Naugatuck. The town itself put it up and then rented it out to people. There's a whole row of development houses that are basically the same form but just slight variations to give each one some individual character. As you can see, a tremendous amount of building went on in the town in that period. Many of these houses were so standardized in construction that a lot of the work could be prefabricated and assembled on the sites. Here we have the Howard Whittemore Memorial Library as it was built in 1894. This year is its 100th anniversary. This is when the desk was right in the lobby where you walked in, and the stacks were on the right side as you walked in. The left side was the reading room. This is the reading room portion here. You'll recognize those beautiful columns. This room had quite elegant woodwork, which fortunately has been retained as it was designed by McKim, Mead, and White, the leading architects in America who designed the building. Here the librarian has been helping someone with reference books. Again, this is in the reading room where many of the bookcases there displayed recent acquisitions. And the magazine shelves, the library has always taken many of the leading periodicals so that people who do not wish to subscribe to them, themselves can still have access to them, as well as local newspapers. And then there were reading periods for the children, where children of certain age would gather in the library and be read to by teachers or librarians. Originally, we had a children's library down the street next to the town hall. When the Savings Bank and the Naugatuck National Bank in particular built a new building on Church Street next to the town hall, they later abandoned this for their own buildings, and Miss Gertrude Whittemore had that building rebuilt as a children's library. Unfortunately, it had to be removed for the expansion of the town hall facilities. This is at the YMCA, which became an important community center. The YMCA provided facilities for many things that aroused the interest of youngsters. Here we're jumping around a bit. We're in the police department. This is up on the Neri building. I don't know just what they're doing, but they're fixing the roof or what. And there you see the old town hall of 1882 in the background. That was demolished in the 1960s. Originally it was a red brick building with granite trim, but at one time it was decided to paint it yellow for some reason. This is in front of the Neri building. Now we're at the post office, where mail is being sorted, being put in various compartments for various carriers to pick up, and the parcel post department. Buying stamps at the window there, parcel post packages. The Naugatuck Daily News, of course, has been the local paper since around the 1880s. This just shows a townhouse and a paper boy setting up his bicycle and with his paper bag, setting it down so he can take out papers to deliver in the neighborhood. This is a service we still have, but now often they use an automobile. And here is the press printing the paper. This is Bill Lukers, who was a reporter for the Naugatuck News for some time, later went to the Waterbury papers. This appears to be a graduation. Central Avenue Elementary School. It may be the Central Avenue School. This is the old Central Avenue School, which was a wooden building. quite a handsome looking building, but after it was decided wooden buildings were not suitable for schools, Central Avenue was demolished in 1956. Shiny new car, some grading equipment. Appears to be preparation for school expansion. Modern school structure with steel framework. McGinn was, of course, one of the large contractors in Connecticut years ago and did a tremendous amount of building of large brick structures. We're, of course, the builders of some of our schools here in Naugatuck. Unfortunately, from some of these pictures, it is difficult to tell what these structures are, and since we don't have the original script or soundtrack, it's not possible to say precisely what they are unless you can recognize something in the area. This appears to be further housing development. This is up at Marty's Corner, I guess. And these are many of the houses built up on the hill on the west side of town there. That was a tremendous development program, and this is one of the more pretentious houses. This was Howard Bristol's house, Austin Adams' house, in English Tudor style. That one was built in 1928 when the economy was booming. These appear to be back down in some of the Hop Brook development area. This, I believe, is a Memorial Day parade and ceremony. This is down in the Catholic cemetery. after World War II, of course, Memorial Day became a very important day and was celebrated with considerable pomp and circumstance. Placing wreaths was always a big affair at these events. This is another Memorial Day event. This is, I believe, at one of the fraternal organizations. Here's Bill Stokes, who ran the Stokes Paint and Paper shop on Church Street. This must be down at the Elks. In the reading room area. This is when it was in the Nary building. One of the pastimes in those days was, of course, sporting events. Naugatuck was a very sport-oriented community, both in the schools. Its high school teams were famous throughout the state, and it also had many local events sponsored by various societies and clubs. This might be a 4th of July celebration, since it looks like a patriotic event with various speakers. This is coming out of the YMCA. This is when the local Rotary Club met at the YMCA and ate in the cafeteria there, and these are various businessmen coming out after the meeting. There's Hilding Olson of the National Bank and some of the other well-known people in town of the period. Mr. Rodenbach. Harry Benham. Jerry Murphy. Don Brubaker, Henry Meckel. Mrs. Fenneman, who was active in politics. To get everybody's picture as he went by. Unfortunately, the words of wisdom they were uttering have now been lost. There's Sherman Brown, who later ran the Naugatuck Lumber Company. Various other businessmen. Eddie Lingenheld, who used to be down at the Savings and Loan. This appears to be some kind of a picnic, maybe a Sunday school picnic or something of that sort. There seems to be a bubble gum chewing contest. There's Annalise Eriksson Lindgren and her brother. This may be a hillside church picnic. Apparently, bubblegum was considered important art. There is Walter Anderson, who ran the hardware store on Church Street at one time. And various races, two-legged and three-legged races. Thank you. parade coming down Maple Street past the central office. With the old town hall in the background. Looks like some junior league baseball game. Stands down at recreation field. Stokes again. He was active in many of these local affairs. This apparently was taken just to show the advertising around the field for local promotion. Everybody will recognize this gentleman. Who did a lot for sports in this community. This was one of the organizations to get youngsters interested in becoming law-abiding citizens. The Soapbox Derby. That's been going on for a good many years in Naugatuck. Car sponsored by Naugatuck News. Thank you. This appears to be a Halloween parade. They used to sponsor a parade on Halloween late in the afternoon or early evening. The Girl Scouts are having some kind of a special event with races, relay races and whatnot. You have to pick up a hat and put it on and wear a jacket backwards and then run back and take it off and the next person puts the hat and jacket on again. Boy Scouts were very active in Naugatuck in those days. This is Troop 2 in Naugatuck, which used to meet at the Congregational Parish House under Cecil Matson. They are here making Fire by Friction. When they get an ember glowing, they use some tinder. And by blowing, this is Cecil Matson showing how this can be ignited, by blowing the ember and getting the tinder to come into flame. There he has succeeded. That shows the board with the various knots they are learning to tie. Signaling. Oh no, this is an egg racer carrying an egg and a spoon back and forth. Picking up rocks. Presentation of awards. This is apparently some lighting for the Christmas season. That looks like the tree on the green. This looks like a village set up maybe on the green. Here we have snow. We had some pretty big snows in the old days. As if the car doesn't have enough snow, they're still throwing snow on top of them, top of it. That was good weather for a sleigh. You used to see sleighs around 50 years ago. They're not very common now. Some people like to unload their roofs of snow, since the weight sometimes was quite a strain when it got very deep. This car will take a while to get excavated.